Your doctors want your LDL under 70? Where did they come up with that number? Did they do a close study of all your factors and decide that's a healthy target? Well, let's look into that. Stay tuned. So today we're going to look at what's called a standard of care. It's something your doctor is probably following. There's a lot to choose from. I've just happened to choose this one, which seems to be very commonly used. And that is the 2018 Guideline on the Management of Blood Cholesterol. Now, after that 2018, there is a veritable alphabet soup of organizations. You see the organizations that participated in this. One of the things that bothers me a little is there doesn't seem to be any organization in there that is likely to be statin hesitant. And make no mistake about it, this may be a guideline on the management of blood cholesterol. It is a statin guideline. I mean, it's 95% statins. They do little talk about things like Zetia, but that's very uncommon in this report. This is a 72-page report, 48 pages of content, 24 pages of references. They did keep industry out of it. In this report, they tell of an incident in which one of the panelists turned out to have a relationship with industry just by virtue of having participated in a clinical trial of some kind. And they didn't realize, apparently, that that would disqualify them. But once that was discovered, they were removed from the panel. All their work was thrown out and was restarted by other people on the panel. So this standard of care had a summary of recommendations right up front, which was very good. There was 10 major recommendations. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to go over each of those recommendations as quickly as I can and just rank what I feel about them on the Russell meter that's going to be at the bottom of each slide. If I rank it to the red side, I don't like it. If I rank it to the green side, it means I like it. So recommendation one is this. In all individuals, emphasize a heart-healthy lifestyle across a life course. Well, there's not really anything to dislike about this recommendation, and it is a good starting one, because while there are people who have genetic predisposition or through accident or things not under their control do have heart disease, for most of us, better lifestyle choices would help us to avoid or minimize heart disease. And that means diet, sleep, exercise, reduction in stress, all that sort of thing. I rank this recommendation as very highly, off to a good start. The devil is often in the details because they don't tell you what is a healthy lifestyle. They just say live a healthy lifestyle and they give a bunch of references. And I chased down some of the dietary references, for example, and I found them to be the standard fat phobic, stay away from red meat, eat lots of whole grains. That aside, this recommendation, as it is written, just those words up at the top, a very good recommendation. Recommendation two, in patients with clinical heart disease, reduce LDL with high-intensity statin therapy or maximally tolerated statin therapy. A patient with heart disease, I'm not sure whether they're considered primary or secondary. I think you actually have to have had an event to be into secondary prevention, but this is maybe somewhere in between primary and secondary prevention if there is such a thing. I generally don't comment in these circumstances. My objections to statins are when we give them to healthy people and we ruin their health by doing it. So in this case, I wanted to take a neutral stance and just say, this is a recommendation I don't want to touch. However, that phrase, maximally tolerated statin therapy, what that means is give them as much as you can and they can still tolerate it. So in other words, we're going to make them as miserable as we can, but not quite send them over the edge. What we should be doing is the minimally effective, not minimally effective, but the minimal dose that is effective. And I think that's a far better approach. Recommendation three, in very high risk people with heart disease, use an LDL threshold of 70 milligrams to consider additional non-statins to statin therapy. In other words, they want to add Zetia if they're giving you a statin. Well, very high risk includes a history of multiple major events that you still survived, or one major event and multiple high risk conditions. This is classic secondary prevention. I don't like to comment on secondary prevention as it is. This is not medical advice, it's just my opinion. But I would hate for somebody who is in a very dire strait to be arguing with their doctor just because some guy on YouTube says he doesn't like statins. You're in a different situation if you're in secondary prevention. That's why I take kind of a neutral stance on this one. I just don't want to argue it. Recommendation four. In patients with severe primary hypercholesterolemia, it's an LDL level greater than 190, without calculating the 10-year heart disease risk, begin high-intensity statin therapy. Well, I have a lot of problems with this particular one. First of all, this whole 190. Well, if you look at the text that goes along with this that's in the report, I don't have it on the screen, they basically say if you can't get it below 100 when somebody is at 190 or above before treatment, then start adding other things like Zetia, something like that. Well, if 190 is a problem, we'll get to that in a moment, but if over 190 is a problem, why are you trying to get it under 100? How about just getting it under 190? I mean, maybe I can understand not trying to get it just to 189, but if it's over 190 and if that's truly a problem, get it down to 160 or something. But no, they want to get it way down. And there just seems to be no logical justification for that. Secondly, here's a chart that I've shown before. This one happens to be from a Korean study of 12 million adults, about, I forget, 900,000 of them maybe were in this age group. Similar results from studies of Americans where we look at all-cause mortality. So granted, I'm getting out of the realm of just cardiovascular mortality, but all-cause mortality versus typical cholesterol levels. And you can see that around 220 is statistically where the people who live the longest, where their cholesterol levels are. So let's dig a little deeper into that, the dotted lines I added. Let's look at somebody who's got like a 280. Statistically, that's as healthy from a mortality point of view as a 160 level. So why are you trying to get somebody down to 160 when they're already, if their cholesterol is very high, or if their cholesterol is only 260, they're actually already better than that. And 160 seems to be what they try driving people to. But the point is, it's very hard to be at 280 and not be over 190. So we're just 190 for LDL. So we're just saying, oh, we're going to take all these people who are healthier than the people with very low cholesterol, and we're going to start messing with their cholesterol. It just makes no sense to me. I give this a very poor ranking. Recommendation 5, in patients between 40 and 75 with diabetes and an LDL of over 70, start moderate intensity statin therapy without calculating the 10-year risk. Like the previous recommendation, it's like, let's just throw out the risk calculation. Well, the risk calculators include whether a person has diabetes or not. What we're going to do is we're going to get them into a tug of war. We're going to say, somebody who's got diabetes, we're going to give them a drug that's actually going to increase their probability to make their diabetes worse in order to get their LDL down. And even though we already have a risk calculator, we're going to ignore that. Getting your LDL below 70 means your total cholesterol is probably going to be somewhere in the range of 120 to 140. That's ridiculously low to be trying to drive somebody to take away their cholesterol. Cholesterol is important for so many body functions. To be messing with it like this, it's an absolute nightmare. I just don't get it. So I give this a poor ranking. Recommendation 6. Again, in adults 40 to 75. And the reason they mention the 40 to 75 is because people younger, they're generally not talking about. And people older than 75 initiating statin therapy, they admit initiating statin therapy for somebody over 75 is not likely to yield benefits. Somebody who's already on statins, when they hit 75, they're saying, yeah, keep them on them. That's just their position. So in adults in that age group, evaluated for primary heart disease prevention, have a clinician-patient risk discussion before starting statin therapy. I like the fact that they're talking about a clinician-patient risk discussion because they talk about factors such as cigarette smoking, elevated blood pressure, LDL, hemoglobin A1C, and the 10-year risk. So yeah, I'm fine with having that discussion. The reason I don't rank this all the way over in the green area is because I doubt that discussion is going to be anything but a browbeating of the patient into taking statins. But if you can get an honest doctor who will really go over the risks and present them fairly to the patient, then I'd be all for this recommendation. So I give it in the green area, pretty high recommendation, but not all the way over. Recommendation 7. In adults between 40 and 75 without diabetes, with an LDL level over 70, there's that, what I call hypercholesterolphobia amongst the doctors again, 70 milligrams. At a 10-year risk of greater than 7.5%, start a moderately intensity statin if a discussion of the treatment option favors statin therapy. In other words, if the patient agrees to it, I guess. I don't understand the fixation on this 70 value because that doesn't give you much leeway to be a slightly above the average, where being above the average is actually not as bad as being way below the average. Also, that 7.5%, that's just a value judgment. That's not, there's no science behind it that says 7.5% is some special threshold. That's a value judgment. Now, granted, it's, you know, doctors looking at the population as a whole and looking at the total number of people who they perceive could be saved. But that's up to you to select that threshold. Is that what makes you intermediate? Well, and what's a statin going to do? It's going to take 2.5% off. Seems like a lot when you compare it to 75%, but remember, you really should be comparing it to 100%. There's a 92.5% chance that you're not going to have a cardiovascular event over the next 10 years. And a statin, in theory, will make it a 95% chance. Is that enough to risk your health other ways by taking statins? That's up to you. So because of that 70 milligrams there, plus the arbitrariness of the 7.5%, I give this one a pretty low rating. Recommendation 8 is very similar. In adults 40 to 75 without diabetes and a 10-year risk of 7.5% to 19.9%, because 20% is the real high level. Risk-enhancing factors favor initiation of statin therapy. And risk-enhancing factors are persistent elevations of triglycerides, chronic inflammatory disorders, high C-reactive protein reading. Yeah, those things really do indicate more danger of heart risk. The problem with mentioning the persistent elevations of triglycerides is statins don't do anything about triglycerides, from my understanding. I mean, I've looked back at my own records from when I was on statins, and my triglycerides were horrible. It wasn't until I changed my diet that I got the triglycerides under control. And that 7.5% is also still the value judgment that I talked about before. But I understand this one, because now we're talking about people who are kind of getting up, certainly if they're at that 19.9%, in other words, 20%, a 1 out of 5 chance of having a cardiovascular event in the next 10 years, that's something enough to be worried about. Given that they're talking about all the other factors in there, risk-enhancing factors, as they're called, I can understand this recommendation. I don't give it a real high mark, but I don't give it a real low mark either. Recommendation 9, in adults between 40 and 75, without diabetes and with an LDL level between 70 and 189, there's that 70 again, at a 10-year risk of greater than 7.5%, in other words, they're in the intermediate level. If a decision about statin therapy is uncertain, well, it should be uncertain. If you're a patient and you're faced with this, especially, you know, these LDL levels, I see nothing wrong with any of those LDL levels. Considering measuring CAC means the coronary artery calcium score. And that's actually a good idea. As much information as you can get in making a decision, the better off you'll be. One of the problems with the CAC score is that you can have a score that's considered high, and you might not actually have a problem. It's an indication of past problems, and you don't want that number to keep going up and up and up. But that is calcified plaque. It's soft plaque that's the danger. So you really have to know how much soft plaque you had. Conversely, you could have a value of 0 and think, oh great, I'm golden, and you might not be. I would combine the CAC score with a carotid intima media thickness test, which will look for soft plaques in your carotid arteries. And that's kind of an indication of, do you have soft plaques throughout your body? And if you don't have any soft plaque, then you're probably okay, especially if you have a CAC score of 0. So I give this kind of, yeah, anything that's going to look deeper into your condition is a valuable thing to do. Just be aware of the limitations of the CAC score and insist on a CIMT or something of that sort. Recommendation 10, assess the adherence and percentage response to LDL lowering medications and lifestyle changes repeated every 3 to 12 months. Well, I'm actually in the middle of this just because I don't like the kind of the prerequisites to this, you know, the LDL lowering medications. Though, if you're changing your lifestyle, repeating the lipid profile actually makes sense. You want to get, you know, an LDL particle test. You want to pay close attention to the triglycerides over HDL ratio. You want to look at oxidized LDL. All these things that are going to tell you more than just the sheer numbers. A value of 190 for LDL could be very safe. It could be very dangerous. It depends on the quality of the LDL. I would recommend maybe a fractionation test that will actually tell you what is the size of the particles. So I have these concerns about these 10 recommendations. First, there's minimal mention of triglycerides. There was that one time where they said, oh, start looking at triglycerides. Triglycerides are a major component. My triglycerides went from 231 down to in the 60s at times. I mean, triglycerides go up and down. I try keeping them pretty low. When they were at 231, yeah, I was actually kind of a mess back then. I just didn't know it, but I was. Now the concern, this 7.5% threshold that they use a lot in these recommendations, that's just a value judgment. I actually use 11% usually to say, hey, that's when we got to start getting concerned, because 11% means there's a 1 out of 9 chance. You know, we're getting into single digits, 1 out of a single digit chance of having a cardiovascular event. I'm not saying you shouldn't worry about it at 7.5%. Maybe you do. Maybe your values say, yeah, I don't even want to see that. And that's fine. That's your value judgment, and you're perfectly legitimate to make that judgment. But it is a value judgment, and this report doesn't really indicate that to anybody reading it. You know, the doctor's going to say 7.5%, that's a magical number. This arbitrarily ignoring calculations if type 2 diabetes is present, that just makes no sense to me, because the calculators actually include type 2 diabetes. They're accounted for. So to be giving somebody a medication and not even considering the calculation, but to give them a medication that's going to actually increase their type 2 diabetes, just makes no sense to me. There's no mention in this report that I could find that considered the statin risks or the patient history with their statins. I have a very bad history with statins, so if I were to go to a new doctor and they looked at my lipid panel and said, you fall under recommendation X, whichever one, I'm going to have to push back and say I absolutely will not take statins under any circumstances. That's my choice, and that's my judgment of what's best for me. You can choose actually otherwise, and I would not criticize you for saying, you know, I think I need to take statins. I understand that. That's actually, you know, a legitimate thing. Again, going back to the problem of statins being given to perfectly healthy people and making them not perfectly healthy. So in general, my layman's opinion of these recommendations is kind of in the middle. I like some of the recommendations. I dislike some of the others. If you appreciate this content, please like, share, and comment. I love reading the comments. I respond to as many as I can. You know, share your story so that other people in our community can understand that they're not alone in dealing with the bad fallout from taking statins. And if you haven't seen this video, I recommend you take a look at it now. Thanks for listening.